Good afternoon to everybody. Thank you for coming. We'll start according to the rules of the United Nations. We are not waiting to the others. They will come in, come out. But thank you. Despite the weather, you are here. I'm Yuri Sergeyev. I am senior fellow at Macmillan Center, former ambassador to the United Nations. And I'm inviting you to discuss the interesting issue, because this is about the global governance. It is the correlation between the regionalism and globalism. And of course, any other issues around the United Nations, around the regional organization, will be in our agenda. Let me start with some some remarks on the regionalism and globalism. Scholars on regionalism and globalism are suggesting two versions of emerge of regionalism. First is that regionalism is a response to globalization and a reaction to the diverse aspects of global processes in their entirety. The second is based upon the recognition that regionalism emerges from the internal dynamics of the region and the motivations and strategies of regional actors. I'm sharing personally an opinion that although regionalism has often been portrayed as a force that is opposed to the development to globalization, both processes are intrinsically linked with global developments. Moreover, globalization itself can be seen as one of the main drivers of regionalism and regionalization. Regionalism is seen as a more diverse form of integration than that suggested by different theories, although there are also some similarities. Process of regionalization emerge from below and within the region, with communities and societies responding to a variety of push and pull factors to engage in cooperation within diverse types of regionalist frameworks. My personal conclusion before we start our discussion today is that regional organizations are building blocks of multilateral order. They are among principal global players. To discuss these and related issues on the role of regional organization in global governance, I have invited my good friends and former colleagues, two outstanding diplomats, Ambassador Joanne Adamson, who is the deputy head of European Union delegation to the United Nations, and Ambassador of Costa Rica, who today is, will share with us on the regional view in the Central American area and broader. Both of them, they have outstanding career as diplomats, as personalities. Ambassador John Adamson arrived to United Nations from my lovely country, Mali, where she served as Her Majesty Queen Ambassador. In Mali, I served 30-something years ago as a professor at local university. I have a colleague from my group who served also in Mali. So we are both speakers of Bambara.
Excellent.
Ambassador Adamson had an amazing career in the on the Middle East affairs and Arab world. She was the head of the office in Foreign Office, Common Foreign Office of United Kingdom. What is important that one of the most tough discussion in the United Nations is around the arm trade. And Ambassador Adamson was the head of the UK delegation in the Commission on Disarmament. And I do remember how it was not easy to even to approach the some kind of decision on arms trade in the United Nations. Ambassador Adamson has outstanding experience in Palestine problems. She was there. She worked in one of the important body United Nations Relief and Works Agency for Palestinian Refugees. She's an expert in human rights. That's why this is a bright example of the multilateral diplomat, both having experience in different fields. My good friend and colleague, Juan Carlos Mendoza-García, who is ambassador of Costa Rica to the United Nations, also has an extremely bright career. Could you imagine how respected he is in his country that he participated in the elections of the president, nominated from his party, Citizens Action Party. He was the president of Congress for several years. He was opposition leader. He has a nice experience in the debating the free trade zone, and he is ready to answer our questions on that not issue. Well, he worked in different commissions on economic issue, on electricity, on insurance, on access to the water. He's the leader of Movimiento Esperanza group within the party, and he's. And his wife, what is important, they both are very active in the United Nations. Sofia Herrera is the president of Women for Peace, uniting all the women's delegates in the United Nations. And she's extremely active in organizing on a weekly basis all the discussions on the empowerment of women and the role of women in the global affairs. So, unfortunately, she's not with us. Well, it's your fault because most probably she'll be helpful to all of us to touch upon these questions. Well, to save the time and to leave more space for interactive dialogue, I would like to invite in any order, in United Nations order or whatever, Carlos. Please start. It works.
Yes. Okay. Well, first of all, I'd like to thank you, Judy, for inviting me to discuss this important topic with such a distinguished audience. I'm also very honored of being here among such distinguished colleagues. The topic of the discussion that gathered us today is of great relevance and pertinence, considering the great array of regional blocs and organisms that have surged around the globe in an effort to integrate in order to be able to acquire more leverage in a more than ever before globalized and competitive world. In this way, and in order to better structure my intervention around this issue, I will make a quick overview of the mostly historical reasons we have come to build alliances of different nature within the region, and to become somewhat familiar with the particularities that have triggered such a trend in the formation of regional blocs, provide some considerations regarding the importance for a small country like my own, Costa Rica, of taking part of these mechanisms, and to some extent delineate what I consider are some of the biggest challenges these organisms present. I will make a more detailed description of the organisms in which Costa Rica takes part within my region. Regionalism in Latin America has developed according to different economic, political, and social factors in order to, in some way, adapt to the specific international scenario of the time. As a consequence, we can see a wide array of regional organisms that in most instances present multiple overlaps with countries belonging to several organizations, each with very different characteristics and purposes from the other. The first generation of regionalism in Latin America was of a sub-regional character, including the common Central American market, which dates back to 1958, the Latin American Association of Free Trade, 1960, and the Andean Pact, all of which had a main objective to improve the economic development of their respective countries that constitutes them. This was meant as a strategy in order to be able to cope with the more competitive extra-regional markets and which favor mostly economic intra-regional relations. No political or cultural relations were included within these schemes at those times. During the 70s, as a consequence of the oil crisis and the high external debt of many countries, these blocs transformed themselves to a new regionalism geared more towards liberal economic policies. In the 80s, which has come to be known as the lost decade for Latin America due to the deep economic recession in which the region fell, affected greatly the foundations of these regional organisms. And as a reaction in the 90s, a new regionalism was born in Latin America. Countries deepened their economic integration, privileging sub-regional blocs aiming to strengthen their economic unity. It is then when the South American Common Market, Mercosur, is created, the Tegucigalpa Protocol comes into effect, which brings back a renovated Central American integration system in 1991. And in 1996, the Andean Pact is transformed into the Andean Community. All these integration mechanisms were established as a means to improve the negotiation power and autonomy of these countries within the context of multilateral trade. Negotiations that culminated, as we all know, in the creation of World Trade Organization at the end of 1994. This economic regionalism came also within an increased role of Latin America as a regional political actor, thanks to the institutionalization of the Grupo de Rio, which constituted itself as a forum of mostly intra-regional dialogue, but that also started to look outside to other parts of the world, establishing in this way a formal dialogue with the European Union. After this, other organisms followed suit and started establishing relations with the European Union as well. Inside of this, the United States started looking for ways in which to regain influence in hemispheric relations through the America Summit, created as an initiative of then President Bill Clinton, who also wanted to push forward the Free Trade Agreement of the Americas, known as ALCA, which did not succeed after the negotiations in Miami in 2003. As a result of the financial crisis, a political change started to transpire, and several governments of important countries in the region moved to the left, which inspired another cycle of regionalism. Starting the new millennium, and in attempt to give answer to the multipolarity and increasing interdependence of global changes, new regional initiatives emerge. They do not have commonalities in terms of purpose, however, they share some characteristics. Among these, we can find the Bolivarian Alternative of the Americas, ALBA, created in 2004, as an initiative from Cuba and Venezuela. The Union of South American Nations UNASUR was another entity, and the Community of Latin America and the Caribbean States, CELAC, which has been the last mechanism of this nature created in 2010. A common characteristic of this regionalism is that it focuses more on the political and social issues, shifting from the past, focus more on economic and trade issues. Some blocs, such as SICA and Mercosur, have also experienced transformations that have brought them closer to a more political and social integration. Nevertheless, the economic issues do not disappear, of course, and it's shown by the creation of the Pacific Alliance in Mexico, Colombia, Peru and Chile, established with the objective of creating a free trade agreement among them. As a result, a more balanced structure have been created in terms of economic and geopolitical and ideological interest. As a consequence, this has allowed for a more active role of Latin America in the global governance through debates and a more common positions about conflicts and other issues on the international agenda. The regional multilateralism has thus enabled a greater participation in the global multilateralism. Small countries like Costa Rica have acquired a stronger voice as a bloc, and in this regard, we recognize the great value that these new instances represent to small countries like mine. However, there is also a downside about this proliferation of regional organizations in the region, which has come to such a diversification that has in some ways weakened the different efforts in front of the regional challenges. The increasing number of regional mechanisms of integration and cooperation shows a fragmented region in a political and economic terms. Most countries in the region participate in several fora, institutions, and projects with multiple purposes and give places to compatibility problems among them. Thus, a great concern exists due to the many projects rated and the juxtaposition among them. A better coordination of the spaces and our regional and sub-regional priorities have become a challenge. As we have seen, the formation of economic, trade, or political blocs in the region responded mainly to challenges of the time. Countries formulated their foreign policy around those circumstances and joined accordingly the different mechanisms created as a consequence. However, the priorities in foreign policy vary from country to country. For instance, for some of the countries in South America, the United States is no longer the first buyer of their exports and has come to a second or third place after China or Europe. This reality might be somewhat different for some or all of the Central American countries. For example, Costa Rica has as its main commercial partner is the United States, but there's also the reality of that the Chinese have been increasing their presence and influence in the political and economic ambits. As a result, the priorities of the countries are very different, which make a difficult process for the definition of priorities and in the ways in which to carry on within the different organisms. Today, if we see a map of Latin America and the Caribbean, and a closer look is given to the differences in ideological and political thought of the countries, it can easily be seen the vast differences there are in regime types, ideologies, interests, demographics, economics, and others. Reaching common position has become more difficult than ever, and this constitutes, to my belief, the greatest challenge regional organizations confront today in their participation in the global governance. Let me deepen a little bit in three regional organisms which my country takes part of, so we can see them a little bit in detail. The first and most important of our regional organizations is the Organization of American States, or OAS. The OAS is the world's oldest regional organization. It begins date back to the first American International Conference held in Washington, D.C. between 1889 and 1890 that generated the need to establish the International Union of American Republics and allowed to take the first efforts to create institutions and rules that outline what today is known as their inter-American system. Currently, the OAS has 35 member states of the Americas, and all of them have ratified its charter. It is the principal governmental forum of the region, and its work is based on four pillars: democracy, human rights, security, and development. Its primary objectives are to secure peace and regional security, promote and consolidate representative democracy within the principle of no intervention, to ensure the peaceful settlement of disputes among member states, and to organize common action in the event of aggression to a member state. Furthermore, it has developed instruments to support social, cultural, and economic development, eradicate extreme poverty, and it is a hurdle to democratic development of the peoples of the hemisphere, and to limit conventional armament to be able to allocate those resources to the economic and social development of its members. One of the greatest achievements of the OAS is the consolidation of the Inter-American System of Human Rights, which has a long-standing history. The Inter-American Commission of Human Rights and the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, which is hosted in Costa Rica, are a model in international human rights law and have helped to strengthen the human rights framework within the region. The OAS, however, has serious challenges to address. The first one is to overcome the division and confrontation within the organization, which has impeded all possibilities of joint action and has weakened the very core of the organization. This has to do with finally addressing the issue of Cuba's reintegration to the organization. In doing so, and in accomplishing a more cohesive and united membership, the OAS could also regain its role as a mediator of conflicts or disputes among the countries in the region. The organization has lost a great credibility after its weak responses to recent conflicts within the region, among countries, or within the countries themselves in case where there's been a coup d'etat. Also, taking into consideration the many regional instances created within Latin America and the Caribbean, the OAS has to do much better in articulating relations with new actors and widen in its way its scope of influence and cooperation. Now let me turn to our sub-regional organization, the Central American System of Integration, or CICA, which is the acronym of the name in Spanish. Central America has always been closely related, even before colonial times. After our independence from Spain, several attempts were made to maintain its unity. The first was in 1824 with the establishment of the Central American Federal Republic that began only 3 years after the proclamation of independence from Spain and lasted until its dissolution in 1848. In 1960, the Common Central American Market was established as a free trade zone, and with the adoption of a uniform Central American tariff, with a compromise of building a customs union among the territories of Costa Rica, El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras, and Nicaragua, which were at the time the members of the common market. In the 80s, the integration process suffered a setback triggered by the global economic crisis, internal conflicts, and war. However, after the signing of the peace agreement of Esquipulas II in 1987, it was possible to lay the foundations for regional integration. On December 13, 1991, in the framework of the 11th meeting of Central American presidents held in Tegucigalpa, Honduras, the Tegucigalpa Protocol, which gave rise to the Central American Integration System, CICA, was signed as a new political and legal framework. The Central American Integration Framework ranges from economic and political issues to social economic views that intends to allow for an integral development of the region. Lately, a security component has also been integrated. CICA is constituted by 8 states, the 5 Central American countries, Costa Rica, El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras, and Nicaragua, in addition to Panama, Belize, and the Dominican Republic, which acquired the status of full member in 2013. The population of the whole region is only 57 million people. Proportionally look at, the regional lacks economic power or international economic preponderance. Despite being fairly open economies, the relative and absolute importance, of course, when you compare it to other regions, is minimal. As such, in economic terms, for the CICA countries, being such small economies, it has become necessary to come together as a region. It makes, of course, more sense to partners as the European Union or the United States to establish free trade agreements with several small countries than only one, and that effort was done both in CAFTA, a free trade agreement between Central America and the United States, and also with Europe afterwards. The same will apply for cooperation efforts, for instance, related to security issues, in order to have an effective use of resources. These are being channeled through initiatives such as ESCA, Central American Security Strategy. Today, the region is key to the U.S. War on drugs and controlling the flow of drugs to the American market and Europe. The migration issue also constitutes a common front, especially the Northern Triangle countries and the Dominican Republic. And as such, the United States has maintained presence in the region with an interest in maintaining the region's economic growth and political stability. SICA has proven effective in terms of an economic and commercial union. Nevertheless, in the context of political efforts, the integration efforts are lacking. The increasing conflicts among countries members have impeded a proper integration politically. The divergent views in terms of the nature and depth of the integration also play a role in the divergent perspectives that this integration should take. As mentioned previously, SICA has been very successful in the trade and economic aspects. However, it has grown so much in its structure and has become a very bureaucratic organism that makes it very rigid system. And in this sense, SICA has also become very politicized. And we, Costa Rica as a country, has specifically had some reticences towards two of the organism's main bodies, which are the Central American Court and the Central American Parliament, which have been signaled for favoring impunity due to a very lax sense of immunity of its members. Regarding these two bodies, the organization has also been criticized for not being independent and serving under the suggestions of one member state, issues that have prevented my country from acceding to either of them. And lastly, I would like to, well, and I will say just another comment to this, that we have been making these critics within the system for several years. We have tried to move the debate in which we can make the system more efficient and to allow it to respond better to the necessities of our countries, having, as I've said, very clear that the unity will be of a favor for all of the nations that compose the mechanism. Lastly, I would like to talk a little bit about CELAC, the Community of Latin American and Caribbean States. Was born in Cancun in 2010 and it starts to function in Caracas in 2011. It is an intergovernmental dialogue and political agreement mechanism, which includes permanently all the 33 countries of Latin America and the Caribbean. The CELAC region comprises approximately 600 million people, which portrays a very diverse array of peoples with multiplicity and diversity in cultural and traditions. In its essence, CELAC came about as a mechanism that could somehow balance the region's differences and focus on common interests. As part of its vision, the main objective was to advance the gradual process of regional integration, unity, and carefully balance the political, economic, social, and cultural diversity through respectful dialogue in areas such as social development, education, culture, nuclear disarmament, culture, finance, energy, and the environment. Nevertheless, CELAC was mainly created as a political cooperation mechanism seeking to promote the voice of Latin America and the Caribbean in the discussion of important global issues and consequently aim for a better insertion and positioning of the region internationally. As such, it has promoted a more outward approach seeking to establish a variety of inter-regional political dialogues, looking to diversify in the dialogues that the region had traditionally formed. CELAC has established such dialogues with the European Union, which was a heritage from the Grupo de Rio times, but also with China, the Russian Federation, Republic of Korea, the Cooperation Council of Arab States and the Gulf, ASEAN, Turkey, India, and Japan. Even though CELAC participates of the different political dialogues at the UN, it does not have a negotiating mandate, and until now, no consensus around this issue has been reached. Most of the concerns around CELAC creation were around the issue of efforts of duplication between the OAS and CELAC. Until now, the most obvious one is that CELAC includes Cuba in its membership. Other important differences are that CELAC does not have a formal structure or a secretariat, and its main objective is to serve as a voice for the region in political dialogue. The OAS, on the other hand, is an organization with a formal structure that includes the United States and Canada, with a huge institutionality and a wide-ranging structure in terms of issues to deal with. The fact that CELAC does not have a rigid structure and that it counts with plenty of flexibility to operate provides a great advantage in terms of decision making. However, sometimes even today, the mechanisms and procedures are not clear and may signify confusion and ambiguity in some of the decisions made. The fact that the pro tempore presidency, which rotates every year, it poses some challenges for continuity. On the other hand, in terms of effectiveness as a political coordination body, CELAC also faces great challenges. The main reason behind this is that, as I mentioned before, the political views, interests, and priorities are very divergent among members, and CELAC works under the rule of consensus. And as such, sometimes we can achieve a unified position about some issues, but of course contradictions come, and then we get to the common minimum denominator, which is the one that allows consensus. As the last regionalization mechanism created, efforts towards strengthening CELAC should be pushed forward, we believe, starting by establishing first and above all complementary efforts with other existing organisms, taking advantage of the synergies being generated with the purpose of avoiding duplicities and achieve the most benefits possible for the peoples of the region. And I guess this will apply for every organization in the region. The multilateral schemes constitute a mechanism used by practically every state to coordinate actions in different sectors and at different levels of actions. They should be used in the most intelligent and productive way so that countries, small countries such as mine, can take advantage in the best possible way to the positive aspects that have already established regional organisms and the huge possibilities that can be developed when they are well coordinated and when duplicities are tackled. I thank you for your attention. I will be happy to answer any questions afterwards.
Thank you, Juan Carlos. Thank you for this comprehensive sharing with us of so many different organizations at the regional level. Mm-hmm. Well, Ambassador Adamson, now your time to take the floor.
Thank you very much, Yuri. And it's a real pleasure to be here with Juan as well. I'm glad he's here because I'm not a trade expert. So if you have questions on trade, I can definitely address them in general, but not in specifics. I'm also delighted that Yuri invited me here. Normally, since I started working for the EU delegation in New York, I'm only allowed to speak when all 28 members have agreed every word that I'm allowed to say. So you've actually enabled me to break out of New York and actually sort of give a few more personal thoughts. So I did want to make clear that my remarks today are very much my own personal views. They are not sort of blessed by Brussels or by Federica Mogherini, and I hope that will lead to a more sort of interactive dialogue. I'd like to pick up on something Juan said in his presentation, which was talking about where did these various organizations, regional organizations, come from in the particular area of Latin America and the Caribbean, or in the Americas. I won't dwell in history too long, but I think it's worth, when one talks about the European Union, sort of looking at what it is and where it came from. In its current form, it started 60 years ago in 1957 with the Treaty of Rome, with the original six members. And that was very much a focus of an economic community, so it was the European Economic Area. Although really everybody knows that while it may have been pitched as an economic grouping, politics and conflict lay behind the formation. It was an attempt to bind economies together so that one would avoid the scourge of war, which, if you think back to 1957, was really not that far in the past for many of the generations there. And if you look way back into the 19th century, you look at attempts when Europe, the European nations, tried to come up with a settlement, a post-war settlement. So you go from the Congress of Vienna in 1815 after the Napoleonic Wars, with the Austrian Chancellor Metternich, really the person sort of convening everyone in Vienna. You then go through history to Bismarck, who juggled a very complicated set of alliances. Sometimes only he knew who was allied with whom. And when Bismarck left the scene before World War I, clearly when crisis came in the aftermath of the assassination of the Austrian-Hungarian Archduke, there was no Bismarck around to try and sort of keep the pieces together. After World War I and the Treaty of Versailles, again, what you had was a post-war settlement, very much bringing the peace, dividing up how we're going to treat certain territories. But really, the European Union, in the wake of World War II, was a different approach. It was actually more about integration and not just about deciding who would have which part of Europe to their own. So I wanted to just sort of pause there on where did the European Union come about. Then coming back to the topic at hand, the EU's role in global governance, I would like to start by taking us back to a moment in June of this year. And it won't actually be the moment you think I might talk about. You can tell by my accent where I'm from, or at least you hope you can. I'm from the United Kingdom. So you might think I'm going to talk about Brexit, and actually I'm not, although I might later. What I'd like to talk about is 3 days after Brexit, in fact, on the Monday afterwards, and I happen to be in Brussels myself preparing for this posting, a very interesting document slipped quietly into the hands of the European heads of government in Brussels. And that document was called the Global Strategy. It was a new global strategy produced by High Representative Federica Mogherini and members of her team. And it was the first sort of comprehensive restatement of, if you like, the EU's role in peace and security since the time of Javier Solana, when he had been the High Representative. So imagine this: to everybody, the world's attention is focused on Brexit, and a mass of journalists, and in another room, quietly, this groundbreaking document sort of finds its way into the hands. And actually enjoys a rather smooth sort of adoption by all of the member states. And whether it's, people weren't really sort of paying attention or for whatever reason, it is taken on board by the member states. And not only that, but just yesterday, a segment of this document, which deals with new security and defence arrangements, has now passed through the foreign ministers of the European Union. So I think that points out to me the danger of only looking at one sort of with one lens on what's happening at a given time. Because whereas you have the big story of Brexit and the challenges to the EU, at the same time you have an attempt to renew the confidence, and particularly renew the confidence in the external facing aspects that the EU can play. I'd like to offer a definition of what is global governance. I'm not an academic. I haven't looked it up sort of online as to what Yuri might have defined it as. But my own sense of global governance in this context and what the EU does is we're talking about rules-based systems and structures, norms, cooperation, and partnership. So it is both a set of things and a way of operating which forms global governance. It's not a world government or a world parliament. And global governance can cover areas as diverse as peace and security, climate change and environment, development, trade, human rights, and the whole values agenda. So I'd like to, when I talk about the EU in global governance, I want us to sort of think quite broadly that it's actually as much about action as it is about forums for discussion. Sometimes action takes longer than others, but that's basically the objective of it, is to is a group of countries, 28 countries, and the EU institutions to come together to pool their assets, their tools of operating, to partner with the rest of the world. So I'm taking a rather narrow view here. I'm not necessarily talking about internal EU instruments or trade. I think there are others who are better qualified than myself to talk about that. But I do want to focus a little bit back on this global strategy document because it has in it a whole segment on global governance for the 21st century. And if you'll allow me to just quote a little bit from that, just sort of give a little bit more detail. What it says in there is the EU is committed to a global order based on international law, including the principles of the UN Charter. This commitment translates into an aspiration to transform rather than simply preserve the existing system. So a rather ambitious sort of, if you like, outline of what we down in New York at the United Nations are all about. And it goes on, without global norms and the means to enforce them, peace and security, prosperity and democracy, our vital interests are at risk. And then it goes on to say, guided by the values on which it is founded, etc., etc. The commitment also talks about the EU striving for a strong UN as the bedrock of the multilateral rules-based order, to develop globally coordinated responses with international and regional organisations, states and non-state actors. I won't read more from the global strategy. I hope anyone who's interested in this topic will actually go and read it. It is a readable document. Sometimes when I've seen EU documents, I would not say that is the case. When I've read UN documents, I would not say that is the case. But if you read the global strategy, it is quite quite easy to read. I'd like to focus a little bit on opportunities and challenges at this particular moment in time, sort of pivoting from, you know, where are we coming from in a general sense to what are we working on in the UN and the global system in a more detailed way. Looking back over 2015 and taking this theme of global governance, I think you would say that the highlights of the year were achievement on the climate change agreement in Paris and agreement on the sustainable development goals. There may have been other sort of breakthroughs. One could also talk about Iran, but I think that would take me down a rabbit hole from which I will never return. So I'd like to talk about sustainable development goals and climate change. They were achieved through a lot of effort by a number of not just member states, but also by the leadership of the United Nations itself, and not least Ban Ki-moon, the outgoing Secretary General. Sometimes you read commentary about Ban Ki-moon and talking about how he hasn't managed to resolve this and that, in particular Syria, I would draw into that category. But in fact, if you look at some of the landmark agreements he was associated with on sustainable development and climate change, then you can say he leaves with some significant achievements. clearly with both of those agreements, the challenge is implementation. I've been a negotiator on and off, I think, now for about 25 years, and I have one motto, and that motto is to negotiate as though implementation mattered. I say that because quite often when you have these massive gatherings of governments, it can sometimes feel like it's just about getting out of the room with a piece of paper, and very often the implementation phase is forgotten in the negotiation. So certainly with the climate change agreement, there are some very sort of clear roadmaps within that as to what regional organisations and states have to do, what civil society has to do. So that's rather clear. Sustainable development goals, I think it's less clear at this point what the roadmap is to achieve by 2030, the 17 different goals in all their sort of sub-goals as well. And right now at the UN, a lot of people are thinking, scratching their heads, how do we actually try and pivot the UN system, partner with business, partner with civil society, partner with national governments to bring what is a set of objectives and statements to something that looks a little bit more like a plan. And to have each of the 193 nations also thinking, how do I translate the goals to be a plan? So that will always be, I think, for the UN, one of the biggest goals is to move beyond documents and rhetoric to actually have a plan which is measurable on the ground. And in fact, one of the problems with measuring is sometimes nations themselves don't have the tools to know how to measure how far they've come or not come. So SDGs is a very, very complicated set of different aspirations that certainly our delegation with partners will be looking at in the new year. A quick word on the new Secretary General. There are lots of hopes on the shoulders of Mr. Guterres, and they range from peace and security issues, Syria, Yemen, Middle East peace process, right through to how to implement the SDGs, how to revitalise the UN system, how to reform and promote efficiency, all of which is happening with a new government coming into place in the host nation. So Anthony Guterres has a lot of challenges on his shoulders. Other challenges that I would want to point to in this endeavour is the rise of populism and chipping away at the international system, if you like, the system of governance. I could mention in that context the ICC and withdrawals of a number of African countries from the ICC. I could talk about the work that I do on a daily basis on human rights, where I'm trying with my team and other partners of other nations to reinforce some norms that have been agreed over the last 10 or 20 years, whereas other countries are trying every year to sort of fight each year, let's have a fight again about that particular human rights norm. So the work is by no means done. And I would say, and I'm going to sort of try and bring this to a conclusion, because I think it would be quite interesting to have a bit of a debate, is the construct that I've talked about, sort of set up after World War II in Europe, if you like, going from the economic entity, then with political cooperation layered on, and has also coincided with the building of a UN architecture from the 1940s, the different instruments that have been developed, the Human Rights Council, and a number of many, many different treaties and conventions. And what you have is, I think, a big challenge. You have a lot of different business and stuff going on in the international system, and sometimes it's simply hard to keep up. That is one sort of very practical thing, I would say. As delegates in New York, trying to keep up is tough. But secondly, there is a trend of rowing back and trying to pick apart things that have been agreed over the last sort of 20 to 30 years, I would say. I will stop there because I could go on and on and on. And as I said, since I'm not answering to the 28 now, I could just sort of talk all night about how it is working at the UN. But I'll stop there and leave it open to questions.
Thank you, John. Thank you for that. And on behalf of the third colleague who is missing at the table, Ambassador of African Union, Tete Antonio, I apologize, but he got the instructions today from the High Commissioner of African Union to move to Washington and to take part in it, to take part in the discussion. Well, okay, some of our colleagues, they are going to Washington for political pleasure, some of them coming to Yale for intellectual pleasure. Well, so floor is yours, dear colleagues. Well, I invite you, if you have questions, please start. Please, Gertrude.
Thank you very much for
this
opportunity.
Name yourself, please, and short question.
Yes, my name is Gertrude Anseku. I'm a Fox Fellow here at Yale. I come from Ghana. My question would go to Her Excellency, the head of delegation for the EU at the United Nations. I come from a continent where the highest regional body, the African Union, is said to be modeled after the European Union. And unfortunately, we don't really see signs that the AU wants to take after the EU. An African proverb has it that if a game is going to be interesting, you see it from the morning. Maybe somebody would argue that it is early years yet, but from the signs that we are seeing, there isn't much to indicate that we want to tread the path of the EU. May I ask Her Excellency whether there are any existing collaborations to carry the AU along so as to make it more efficient in dealing with the many challenges that we have with peace, security, and development in the continent? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I'm just coming from West Africa, so actually when you talk about Ghana, it sort of, it makes me miss being there, because there's many, many things I miss about a bit about being there. There are actually some existing cooperative mechanisms. One of them, in an area I was interested in Mali, was a joint EU-AU commission, if you like, on peace and security. And what that commission would actually do was do joint visits to certain areas where we were cooperating on the ground. So I saw that myself in Mali, that there was a mission organized out of Brussels and Addis Ababa where people would come together and at least actually try and brainstorm about what were the key issues and what could each group try and do to sort of support and help the resolution of conflict. So that was one area. The other thing that I think is a growth area a little bit more on the European side is committing more into the common security and defence policy area. And by that, I mean things like mentoring on the security and defence side on the ground. Again, in Mali, you have a mission called the EU Training Mission, which is getting alongside the Malian armed forces, trying to bring in a model of civilian governance of armies after the coup and then the war in northern Mali. We very much felt that the existing army itself needed some kind of support to rebuild, but also to build it up on a model of civilian governance. And at the time, I don't want to talk too much about the UK role because I'm very much, you know, in my EU hat on, but the UK was very strong on ensuring that there was an IHL and gender component into the curriculum. So any training that the soldiers were getting on, you know, how to shoot a rifle straight or how to hold your ground was always accompanied by this is why IHL matters and actually why it can help you to win the battle, can help you to win the village you're working in or whatever. So there, I think that area from in a very practical way, the more EU missions there are. And I think Africa is definitely a continent where we've already got a number of missions in CAR, in Mali, and really to think about this sort of practical training, but also to be joining up with other actors. So UN missions that are there. I think one of the big problems often that you raise about people, will they adopt this model or that model, is there isn't really enough cooperation at the planning stage of things. And probably the more that can be done when you're planning, executing, and then finishing a mission, the better. The other thing mentioned in the global strategy is wanting the EU to be fully integrated in the cycle of conflict. So putting more in on preventive diplomacy side, then accompanying through conflict itself and post-conflict. But the focus on preventive diplomacy, I think itself will be an interesting inroad to address the question you raise. However, my experience at the UN is that quite a few countries are simply saying, no, I don't want to deal with you at all. I could cite Burundi in that category, Burundi is dealing with UN bodies. So it is a challenge. You're right. The question you raise is a real challenge. But then again, I can't speak for the African Union. I think it would be good to have some views from them as the direction the EU is going. But certainly the EU will be, I think, doing more on the ground and more on this coordination side, looking at the whole of conflict cycle. Thanks.
Thank you. Please.
Have the question for you, Madam Ambassador. Taking advantage of the fact that you are not censored by your 28 bosses, I'd like you to talk as frankly as you can about two issues. First, what can, in your view, the European Union do in view of their Trump triumph, Trump card used by the Americans now against the rest of the world in a way, and including the European Union? What can the European Union do to prevent something like that from happening in Europe, in France, in Germany, in other countries, in the future elections, in the European integration process? How realistic is it to prevent the rise of populism, including right-wing populism? And related to this, coming from Ukraine, as Yuri is, I am interested in how true is that the move of the European Union to give the visa-free regime to Ukraine is now blocked by attempts, by wishes of some leading members of the European Union to first kind of change this very regime within the European Union to make clear that this visa-free regime can be suspended at any moment without any notice, and kind of punish Ukraine for some problems of the EU itself in a way, regardless of the fact that Ukraine has implemented all requirements, has fulfilled all requirements of the European Union, which were set in advance as a precondition for this visa-free regime.
Professor Kulik.
Okay. Thank you, Professor. So on the first one, let me say a word about the election result here and the way the EU has been responding, and then I'll talk about the populism thing you raised. I mean, in the first instance, the foreign ministers met in Brussels on Sunday night, and there was a very clear sense that actually they would like to make contact with the transitional administration here and to be open to cooperation, while being clear what our values are, and sort of setting out this is where the EU is working and what we're doing globally, and we'd like to meet on those terms. And I think not making too many assumptions is probably for us, certainly in the delegation, is not to be sort of saying we know with precision this is what's going to happen on January the 21st. So to be open to cooperation in certain areas. In terms of the phenomenon, and you could put Brexit into the same bracket as that, I think there's, and this really is where I'm sort of drawing on my own personal experience now, I think there is a communication issue on the one hand. There is something about explaining what the European is and what it does and what the benefits are. There is the impact of the 2008 recession on Europe is probably still being felt. So actually when Juan was talking about what happened after the 1980s, I was kind of cheering up a little bit when you mentioned how Latin America went through the 1980s, and then, but I do think that what happened in the 2008 recession and afterwards, combined with the loss of a number of major sort of key industries in certain countries, that actually all contributed to a narrative in some parts, certainly in the United Kingdom, which equated globalization with the European Union directly. And one could sort of go into that a lot and argue, you know, was the steel industry moving to Southeast Asia to do with the European Union, or was it something else? But the fact was that these phenomena, they were seen as causation rather than correlation, if I can put it that way, in the minds of many. And then you put the factor of immigration then into that mix, and people saw it as the vote was a chance to say, no, actually, I am voting for change. So I think, you know, actually trying to boil it down, what is it you could boil it down to, is people saying, I am voting for change. Now, I'm no political sort of pundit to say, how can you stop X, Y, and Z, or how do you do it? But I do think that looking at the narrative that there are in certain regions of certain countries, you really have to embrace that. I'm myself from the north of England, and I must say that one of my own learning points was, you know, I wasn't really hearing it myself, even though I knew from circles I was moving in, I was hearing certain rhetoric. But I think not being complacent is one, but also obviously having to work on economic rejuvenation, and that's certainly, you know, if you look at the narrative here about the Rust Belt, absolutely, that's one of the core things. On Ukraine, I confess I do not know the details on the visa regime, so I'll put that sort of straight on the table, and could through Yuri sort of get back to you on that. What I would say on Ukraine is I think the EU has taken some very strong steps, including in the differentiated relationship we now have with Russia, cooperation in certain fields. At the UN, we've been busy this week actually supporting Ukrainian mission on a resolution which they are running about Crimea and the human rights situation in Crimea. So that there are a number of areas where the EU has been active. Also, looking at this new global strategy, you'll see quite a lot about not a common European army, but about positioning so that it's clear that European states are investing in their armed forces, etc. So it's a positioning and a status, if you like, of it's a posture.
Thank you. Any other questions, please, sir?
Thank you very much. My name is Nicholas Alipui. I teach a course here. I'm also from Ghana. Thank you for sharing the global strategy and the perspectives therein. Clearly, the EU is doing a lot of work developing policy and leading policy development work in key areas of international development. And I think that's something to be commended. And the global strategy falls within that context. I wanted to pick your brains a little bit with respect to the issue of migrants, refugees, and the massive challenges that we've been experiencing in the humanitarian context. Clearly, the fact that Europe has been impacted quite directly in various unprecedented ways. Wanted to know, because whatever Europe does with this crisis is going to set a kind of a global framework in place that would guide future policy work in this area. Wanted to know where things stand at the moment, first with respect to the refugees, those that cross borders and seek asylum in a third country, or migrants, including economic migrants that come from economically depressed zones, Africa and others, and where you think this is all going and what we might expect in terms of international development. Thank you.
I'm wondering whether Juan might also want to sort of chip in on that as well.
I have several questions for him.
Yeah, okay. Well, what a great set of questions. I mean, again, this is sort of such a massive topic. I think the first thing I'd say is that the summit which took place in New York this year, to me, represented a recognition that this migration, massive movements of people, is a global phenomenon, that actually Europe could do so much, but it has to be addressed in a global context. So I think we very much welcome the two summits that took place in New York. I'll say a word about what's happening on them, and then I'll talk about the Europe sort of situation as well. So after the summits, there should be two global compacts negotiated, one of which will be on migration and one of which will be on refugees. And the aim is, certainly on the migration one, to have a global compact agreed by the end of 2018. And the Mexican and Swiss ambassadors are working together now to try and, you know, in the UN there's always a very bureaucratic process that has to underpin everything. So they're working on what's called a modalities resolution, which will convene whatever that sort of intergovernmental thing will be that will produce a global compact. So that's exactly what's going on right now, is, you know, we've gone back into the drafting phase and a lot of consultation going on. There will also be the global compact on refugees, where I would expect that UNHCR will actually play quite a role in developing that. So that's the first thing I would say, is that the September events put these issues into a global context, which we welcome. Then returning to the European arena, and actually it's not just the European arena, it's the Mediterranean, whether it be the West, East, It's sub-Saharan Africa and North Africa. It's Syria. There's all sorts of. So it's a very complex issue. What I would say is, I think the events of the last 3 years showed that the response could not just be about sort of either processing, rescuing at sea, or, you know, unfortunately dealing with people who've been lost at sea. The discussion had to go much further and start at, particularly on migration. Let me talk about migration first. What are the root causes that are leading people to migrate? And, you know, one of the first things I always say is, you're looking at the headlines of migrants in Europe, but have you seen how many countries in Africa host migrants, or, you know, regular migrant workers? West Africa is a great case in point, where you have a lot of people from Mali, Niger and elsewhere going to the coastal states to work. And there is this huge sort of sustaining blanket around some of the poorer states and those in conflicts. So one of the first things to do is to ensure that those economies are actually supported and can keep growing and continue to be the vibrant sort of economies around conflict areas. So that was one aspect of it. Some, you know, deep concerns that economic growth, even at its best, cannot keep up with demographic pressures. Again, particularly places in West Africa, where you have Niger with the fertility rate at 7.6 children. However good your economic growth can be, and they are affected by climate change and desertification, it's simply not going to keep up. So you're going to continue to have the problem of migration, people just seeking a place to go and sort of make a living. And I remember in Niger, I was in an IOM office once, meeting quite a lot of people, men and women, who were seeking to actually go home to their places, some from Ghana. Ghana's actually contributes a lot of the statistics you see about people migrating around, trying to get up through Libya. Gambia is another one. The reasons why people want to migrate are very fundamentally to do with them wanting to make a living and have some economic opportunities. So the EU approach on that side has been to try and work up more on, to tailor our development assistance to be more about stimulating local economies and helping governments transform economies to be able to provide some economic opportunities. You then have the issue of what happens when people try and make the crossing. So in some cases, it's about a maritime response where you're actually trying to save lives and make sure people are looked after and treated with dignity. So there's a lot of work gone on to that from the sort of Navy side of the house. Then looking at when people do reach Europe, I think it's taken a long time to get to agree where should those people's applications be handled, should it be? And then once you have handled them, to do some redistribution of people to go and settle in different countries. I wouldn't, though, claim that is all settled, because there are still, I mean, you'll see referenda happening in some countries in Eastern Europe about where people should be settled. Then the final category, which of course is, you know, I don't want to diminish at all, is this huge, very important category, is those people, refugees fleeing conflict, Syria being top of the list there, but I could cite countries in East Africa where the same, you know, huge movements of people. And if you look back to the wars in Sudan, you've got a sort of recent example where South Sudanese, the lost boys, who actually ended up being resettled in the northeast of the US. So this is not a new, and it's not just a European phenomenon. But on that, I think political leaders have had to grasp some of the nettle. The deal with Turkey on resettlement of refugees was not popular in some areas, but at a certain point that was the decision that was what needed to be done to try and actually stop this overwhelming flow where people, states were just not ready. They were not ready to absorb and to treat people with the dignity that I just referred to earlier. So that's a rather long-winded sort of set of responses, but some of it is about saving lives, some of it is about processing and trying to be fair about the numbers of people settling. But really fundamentally on the migrant side, I think it's about a new conversation as to whether the way we're partnering with countries, particularly in Africa, is actually going to mitigate the problem, and how do we work with countries to direct assistance in the right place.
Great, thank you. Okay, briefly.
I wonder if there is any recognition within the European Union leadership and member states about potential limit of limitations of this approach, potential limit of immigration to the European Union, because if you said we have to work with the governments of the respective countries so they kind of increase the living standards of living of people there, so they would not be motivated to emigrate to move to the European Union. Sometimes it works the other way around. Those people who are better off, who are more educated, who are more mobile, who travel around and can compare what's happening in other countries, are more prepared to take a risk and go further and invest into relocation and to further investment, further increase of living standards and enhancement of prospect for their children at least. Yeah, and with regard to Middle East migration, including Syria, not necessarily the war zone itself where people are desperate, where they are fleeing, but in other parts and in Iraq and Egypt, it was observed that it's not the most vulnerable, the most desperate people who moved, because those people sometimes do not have resources to move. Those who do move are better off, more educated again, and more prepared and more willing to pay to those smugglers. Yeah. Simply having those monies, and by allowing, sometimes encouraging, or at least allowing them to move and settle off in Europe, European Union in a way stimulates the outgoing of more dynamic, mobile people who could make a difference in their respective places of residence. Instead, those who are left will be less able to make change, to increase standards and so on. And finally, in your formula of what the European Union is doing, I didn't hear the hit on those smugglers to prevent prevent, to drastically increase the price they would be paying for doing something illegal and immoral and counterproductive in many ways, even if some do believe that they actually helping people in need. Thank you.
Thanks. Let me answer that sort of straight away. The only reason I didn't mention it is there's so many other aspects of this issue that you can. I know from my own experience that that the EU is increasingly having a focus on tackling trafficking rings, etc. Then again, there is a dilemma because in some areas, if you look at Agadez in Niger, for example. Once tourism had gone away in the wake of the terrorist attacks from Al-Qaeda, people were looking to make a living. And unfortunately, a whole industry arose around trafficking and migration. And in fact, until you get to the point of the Libya border, you haven't committed any crime because there is free movement within that area. So you had people, you know, offering their trucks to drive people or whatever. So you, yes, the EU is trying to help the Nigerians tackle migrants and going after the people who are doing the exploiting rather than the migrants themselves. But sometimes you also then have unexpected consequences on, so you have to do it sensitively so that when you're going after this industry in Agadez, you're not then making people, a whole range of people, even more impoverished than they already were. So anything on migration tends to be so complicated. You push here, it goes there. Managed migration is a topic, though, the thing you were talking about, you know, professionals. I think, you know, more and more there is a discussion about you know, what's the carrying capacity of certain countries receiving, what skills do they need. In the UK, for example, the National Health Service, you know, I myself have benefited from fantastic treatment from doctors from all over the place, doctors and nurses. So managed migration, yes. But then on the, you know, are we encouraging people to, are we providing incentives to flee Syria? If you judge by all the commentary and the rhetoric in Europe, I don't think that is a sort of common theme that we are actually, you know, saying, you know, come on. But what there is a strong humanitarian initiative, and one of the other big areas that the EU works on, not just in conflict, but is on general humanitarian assistance. You know, I ought to have mentioned that as one of the areas. But there is in Europe a very strong imperative to try and protect the vulnerable and to help them at their time of need. So there are these like countervailing pressures. I don't deny that.
Thank you, John. Relax a bit. I will ask Juan Carlos one question. Well, because he's the only expert at the table who knows something about free trade zones, because he explained.
Not an expert.
Yeah, but you explain me how you negotiated with your society the CAFTA, Central American Free Trade Zone. The question is that free trade zones. They used to be and still are the important mechanism in global governance. But recently, this mechanism has been questioned. For example, here, NAFTA. NAFTA, the question about the United States, European Union, transatlantic partnership, and you mentioned the attempt of Latin American countries and all American countries to negotiate and to adopt agreement on the intercontinental free trade zone from the south to Alaska. What's about? What's the fear? Nature of the fear is based on. what are the major motivations for these kind of the concerns?
Well. This debate, at least in my country, started back in the 90s when we established the first free trade agreement with Mexico, and then in 2007 I was before telling them that we had a very interesting debate in my country concerning CAFTA in particular. Actually, we brought the issue to a referendum because it was bringing like a very intense debate within the society, whether it was convenient or not to subscribe the free trade agreement with the United States, and it divided Costa Rican society quite a lot. The result was, at the end, 51 voted yes to the free trade agreement, and 48% voted no. In a very tough process, I will say, because it had a lot of political consequences within my country. Of course, when negotiating agreements, one part is the commercial side itself, and then you have all, especially all of the different norms that are incorporated in terms of protection of investors, in terms of how you treat companies from one side to the other, the asymmetries that are within the nations that are taking part of the deal, and the particular situations, realities of every country. In our case, in Costa Rica, until 2007, we had a very particular system in which, from the early 40s, we developed very strong state-owned companies. In banking, for example, we still have more than half of the market in banking is owned by state-owned banks. Then we had an insurance company that had the monopoly of the insurance in the commercial sector. It was a state-owned. Electricity and telecommunications also a monopoly, a state-owned. So there was a big push in the 90s with first to privatize, and that didn't happen in my country. And then with this negotiation, then there was the issue of, opening the market for competition. And these institutions that are very have a lot of meaning within my country, were seen as being in jeopardy, having to compete with big corporations, and what were the terms of the ground for competition, if it was a level field or not, was under the question. And then you got the questions about how, the eternal question if economic growth means distribution or not of that growth within the society. And I think the issue of inequalities is absolutely an issue in the region that I come from, which is the most unequal region in the world in terms of distribution of wealth. And I think that issue is coming to the political debate everywhere, and the past election here was that issue was brought in particular, how the wealth or the benefits of commerce are distributed within the country, and then of course you can relate that to migration as it was mentioned before. For example, in our region, and of course the focus is nowadays in Syria and Europe, but what we're seeing worldwide, and I'm sure other phenomena can be described in Asia and elsewhere, but for example, in my region, we had thousands of Cubans moving to Ecuador and coming from Ecuador to Colombia, to Panama, Costa Rica, and going and trying to arrive here to the United States. We had a lot of African people also going to Brazil and also doing the whole path all the way up.
But it is not because of free trade.
It is not, but not. I mean, that has other causes, and I'll go back to free trade. But just let me go a little bit on migration, because the other issue is in Central America and the Northern Triangle in particular, where a lot of people are migrating to the United States, especially Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador, and that's mainly because of conflicts, but also because of inequalities, and I cannot link that directly to free trade, but you can question whether free trade has decreased or not the inequalities within and among countries. And that's like a debate that I think it has to be put on the agenda. And there are a lot of course, benefits. My country has benefit a lot from free trade as well, and we have more than 95% of our economy open to free trade agreements in the different exchanges that we have, and it helps a lot if done and complemented with the adequate national policies, and especially the capacity of one country to implement it. And you were mentioning, well, if you have the focus when negotiating how to implement, then a lot of things can be changed, because it also comes to the reality of the capacities. And then when we were negotiating the free trade agreement with China, for example, just think about Costa Rica versus China, and how could we defend our economy in front of dumping in China. I mean, what's the real capacities like small economies have to develop the mechanisms to defend or to implement the full range of the provisions that free trade agreements allowed? So that also for us is a challenge in terms of developing the institutionality and the expertise that allowed us to to profit fully from the benefits that free trade agreements could have. I think the debate will keep on going in the next years, and I think it's also important to have clear that also free trade agreements and the conditions that are within the beyond trade and that again have to do with intellectual property, that have to do with protection of investors and others, and how resolution of conflicts in beyond national jurisdictions. All of these issues are to be discussed under the reality of the experience that we now have of some years where we have been dealing with the free trade agreements in our areas.
Thank you. You have a question?
Well, I just wanted to go back and ask how Central America was considering migration and trafficking in persons and human trafficking. And what
Thank you. If I may just add one thing that it was interesting when in the previous question that you were discussing about trafficking, and just to tell you how, like a recent example we had in Costa Rica, we dismantled a trafficking network in the last 2 years, and when we dismantled that traffic network, the whole issue emerged to the surface, and it was complicated to manage it institutionally. Basically because, well, when the networks were operating, people just didn't see the problem, and people were flowing throughout the country. When the network was dismantled, then we say, okay, well, now we have to deal with it. Then the frontier at the north was closed by Nicaraguan military, and they didn't allow the flows of migrants to go any further. We had to make to start discussing with other countries in the region how to make a bridge for them to move further. But it was quite a strange debate, because it was governments discussing how to institutionalize the flows of migrants, which is usually not the where the debate is. And then we have also at the moment a big crisis with people from Haiti that move to Brazil to construct all the infrastructure around the World Championship, the Olympics, and when they run out of jobs, they start moving in tens of thousands numbers through the country, and that has been for small countries as us, when we get 5,000, 10,000 people all at once, of course it makes a crisis difficult to manage under the circumstances, and that's where regional and partnerships, international partnerships are very important to address these issues that are not possible to address them on a nation by nation basis.
Mm-hmm. Great. Any questions? Please.
Hi, my name is Aaron Thomas, and I'm a fairly recent law school graduate and still very much interested in international law and international organizations. And I was just curious what your experiences personally have been, working in, regional organizations or, as a career, what your, successes and frustrations might have been.
Well, my career has been very limited on this side because I've been a congressman before and I come more from the political side. I'm a political appointee. I'm not a career diplomat, so I'm not. I haven't been for a long time within this. But I can tell you just from my brief experience at the UN that Joanne was talking before about the way speeches are and documents are written, and that has called my attention in the sense on how we get accustomed just to separate the narrative from reality sometimes just to adequate it to common agreeable language at a certain point. And I think language is very important and the possibilities of bringing that narrative closer to reality and making it easier for using it as a dialogue and not as a way to separate debates, I think is very important and one of the challenges that I see that are needed to be addressed, the way we communicate and the way we address the narrative of the problems we deal with.
Mm-hmm. I would say on that the on the upside, the moment when we agreed the arms trade treaty, that reflected a very unusual sort of partnership. So in that group was started with seven states. Costa Rica and the UK were actually part of the genesis. Then it built out into states. Then there was a massive lift from civil society, and of all different types of civil society. And so you had defense industry. So you had this sort of strange bedfellows of Women's International League of Peace and Freedom, along with Defense Manufacturers Association of the United Kingdom, who were actually all campaigning for the treaty. And it's sort of surreal when you see that, because quite often people are adversarial. But it showed me the potential to build a coalition, not a military coalition, but a coalition that is so determined that and reflects views of their constituents, views of the people, views of people who are actually affected by conflict. Africa was one of the biggest supporters of the treaty, because they say, hey, it's us who are actually being killed and suffering, so do something at the UN. Now, on the so that's the upside of it. It's the art of the possible when you do something that people say you're never going to do that. The downside of it is when you lose momentum. And so there was one moment before we managed to get the treaty when we actually got a setback when it was 2012 and Obama was facing re-election, and the US basically called time on us and said, no, I'm not risking this with votes. So we were held over for another year. In fact, we ended up with a better treaty, I think, because we didn't rush. But there are major events that can suddenly slow down momentum, and geopolitics intervenes, and you've just got to keep the faith and keep going. But yeah, reality intervenes in all our sort of fine things that we're doing at the UN, then reality bites. But it is still the potential for, I'm very much a globalist, you'll see from my CV, a multilateralist, that actually we are more alike than we are different, and you can just through leadership and being open to partnerships, you can create, it's a very creative profession, I find. At the same time, you need patience to know when you seize the moment and you strike. You have to listen to a load of blah, 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 blah until but you have to have your plan ready. But you need strategic patience, but also a sense of enjoyment of some of the surreal things that you see at the UN.
Thank you, Bo. I can add from my experience as well something. Well, I served as deputy head of mission in the United Kingdom, then as ambassador to Greece, then to France, and then I appeared in the United Nations where I stayed as ambassador for 8.5 years. When I came, I do remember this first day, and I shared with some students, colleagues here. I paid a visit, protocol visit, to one of my colleagues, and asking him advice, what is about the multilateral diplomacy. And his answer was very interesting, close to what you said. He pointed out on the fact that in bilateral diplomacy, when ambassador to a certain country, you don't care about other missions, other embassies. You're working for your country only. But when you are in the United Nations, you're working for your country or for the global community. You have to know each and everybody, not only by face, but by name. Why? Today he is coming looking for your support. Tomorrow you are coming to him looking for his support because your issue on the agenda. I was the president of several committees, including legal committee, six committee, peace building committee, law of the sea committee. And it's exactly what colleagues said about. The rules are to find consensus. It is not always reachable, but at least you are fighting for the consensus or for the broader support. For broader support, you should present yourself in a way to be respected and to respect everybody. This is the way United Nations works. For sure, what this ambassador told me, don't look the immediate result. You are usually fighting for the bilateral diplomacy. Enjoy the process. And the process the process really brings both pleasure when you reach the goals and some disappointments, but you can't take disappointments because you have to move ahead. So this is a family. This is a family where, different personalities. You can't reject them because they are in a whole, and they are to what? Pro or contra what you are bringing in. So that is why this orchestra, if it is not well conducted, so it is a chaos. But so until now we try to find the norms and rules and personal approaches, help this body to govern or to moderate all the global affairs. Juan Carlos was the last of us who met the new Secretary General a few days ago. And all of us, we believe that this is a guy who could lead the nations. But again, personality is very important. But without the those who are in the orchestra, violins, pianos, nothing will happen. So, and this is about the nation states. And I don't know, colleagues, if your perception of the Secretary General Guterres is of mine, that he, at least he brought in the General Assembly the vision that he knows what to do with the body. Mm-hmm. But most probably I'm not right.
No, absolutely. Absolutely. I'm very impressed with the new Secretary General elected and designated at this moment. And I think, one of the things that have impressed me more and that I want to emphasize today is his compromise with gender parity in the organization. I think that will be a revolution within the UN. At this moment, only 22% of executive postings within the organizations are held by women, and he plans to move it to 50-50 at executive positions, and then throughout the organization. I think that that's something that will definitely change the dynamics and will bring, I believe, much better institution for addressing the issues that we need to. And I think besides that, his approach, his knowledge, his sensitivity to the issues, I think will also make us hopeful of the future under his leadership on the organization. Yeah.
I think that I could add on that the way in which he won the race was actually something the European Union was supporting, which was a more transparent process where it wasn't just Security Council doing something in a dark room somewhere picking this. Actually, the best candidate emerged through setting out what he was going to do. And I know, many of us would have loved it to be a female Secretary General for the first time. But what you can't deny is that the new process, which meant someone had to, relate to the whole membership through a transparent process, he was able to take advantage, I guess, of that process. And we'd like to see more transparency in how things are done. I know a number of the Latin American countries, when they've been on the Security Council, for example, Uruguay is one of them, is very insistent on, we need to lift the veil on some of this sort of stuff that goes on at the UN and just explain a little bit more. Yes, there's a need for discretion, and when you're doing negotiations, you need it. But sometimes, you can just shine a light and say, well, this is what's going on. It's not a secret, and the world's public should be able to know what's happening.
So I'm glad that you're here, and we are trying to share our perception of United Nations and general management of the global affairs in a way that it is not just a bunch of blah, blah, and it is not a bunch of hopes. There's a bunch of opportunities, and to have United Nations today when there is no other substitution for that, it's better to have this and to improve what we have and all the opportunities these organization in 70 years of existence could improve, and so we hope that the new elected team will lead. But reforms are important. How easy to move with the reforms? It's a question. Mm-hmm. It's a question, but there is at least. Well, the character of the majority of the nations to bring these reforms. Great, thank you, colleagues. I had a very provocative question, but I will not raise it about. all of us. I mean, all the nations now. They are writing advices to the capitals, to the to the heads of the. The regional organizations, how to work with new administration, what to advise the new administration, how to, elected president here and the new administration, which is in a process of formation, how to improve relations with regional organizations. But this is something which you will not share because the timing is confidential. I know that they are looking strategies, but I wish. you both your missions well to reach all the plans you have from your governments, from the mission, from Brussels. Well, to find a good dialogue with the new administration here. Well, to bring the arguments why the dialogue with free trade zones should be. continued and improved, and well, to have the free trade zone between European Union and United States. I'm grateful to you.
Okay. Yes, let me advance not the whole answer, but just it relates a lot to what Joanne mentioned when she presented her point, which is well, the two possibilities of one of a trend of going back in some very important achievements, multilateralism has had during the past decades. I found myself very disappointed sometimes when we are, for example, discussing women issues and having to defend language that was approved in the 90s that is trying to be a setback at this moment. And from that we cannot go on with different issues that as you were mentioning, are under debate nowadays. So I think there's a very important. It is a very important moment, and when you put that to the side, to the rise of populisms everywhere. I mean, we need to think about how we build on the ideas of our democracy, on how we construct the common good idea. And how can we, within the multilateralism, defend the institutionality and the possibilities of bringing key issues as human rights and to the table without being and sometimes I believe that one of the problems that we have at this moment is that we are on a defensive position, and we are just trying to not to get setbacks. And mm-hmm. Sometimes I think we should go forward and say, well, we are still not in a confrontational way, but in a very propositive and educational way. Because I think that the world definitely needs a change of logic, and sometimes the setbacks are. Should be only like a call of attention to ourselves and how we are dealing with our countries and with our policies and the international community.
I'm going to say one last thing on similar vein for us to pick a few positive areas where we have a positive agenda and advertising again the wonderful global strategy. There are in that document, it actually sets out the positive agenda of what the European Union would like to do. And I think in the UN context, to be careful that we're not constantly fighting, that we pick our battles or that we really focus on important things. I'll give you one example of a resolution that I came across this time, and I was amazed that this still exists. In the second committee, which is the Economic Committee, there is a resolution called Sustainable Gastronomy. Now, I'm the first to love good food. But I really think that, you know, when you look around the world, there are people who are actually food insecure. And each of us will have our pet resolution or our pet issue that we constantly think. We keep bringing it back every year and it's the same result. And in the UN context, sometimes I think we need to kind of rein ourselves in, reset, and actually think all this body of work that's gone before, you don't need to keep sort of hammering through every year the same old thing. So that would be sort of stay on a few positive things, engage with people on what your positive agenda is, but at a certain point, you know, recognize, really focus what is the important thing you can leave behind and what are the important things that you can't.
Great. Thank you, colleagues, and thank you for your presence here and your conversation. Thank you. All the best to you.
Thank you.
Thank you.